Welcome back to the Grio. Back with me for the hour is conservative and former Maryland Republican congressional candidate Kim Klacik. We're talking about a range of issues. Kim, I want to move to affirmative action, but before we do, I want to give you a chance to finish your thought from the previous segment.
No, I appreciate it. So the Republic of Congo, I mean, there's a lot of issues there. Zaire is one of the countries that was moved into that republic. And unfortunately, you have African leaders in that area that has forced the people within that community into slave labor today. Even children are forced into slave labor. And like I said, those are the ones that are extracting the cobalt and the lithium that we find in electric vehicles or laptops or cell phones. And so there are black leaders that have enslaved black children and others. And so you still can't say whether or not our lives would have been better had we not been brought to America. I mean, you just can't say that. Now, could have been? Sure, but we don't know.
Yeah, my only point, I think we've moved the goalposts just a bit. My point was that we have no reason to believe that it wouldn't be. And then you said that we could look to Africa as evidence that even when we don't get mixed up with these folk, we still end up with these outcomes. And my point is, every country that you've pointed to, whether it's Nigeria with the UK, whether it's Congo with Belgium, whether it's Cameroon with the French, every single country has been underdeveloped and exploited by Europe. Every single country continues to be underdeveloped and exploited by global powers. And so it's never like these African people are just in there killing themselves. It's always after interactions with Europe that you see much of this mess emerge. But let's move on, because there's another conversation I want to have right now, and that is affirmative action. As you well know, and many people out there well know, the Supreme Court basically ended race-conscious admissions programs at Harvard and UNC, University of North Carolina, saying that they violated the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. What did you make of that? How did you feel when you heard that decision?
Really quickly, I did want to add that colonization did have issues in Africa. One of them being in Nigeria, there are many people today mad at the Obama administration for bringing in a lot of the LGBTQ ideologies into their country. So I will agree with you there. There has been a lot of colonization even after slavery. When it comes to affirmative action, I would have to say that, you know, as black people, and I think we had this discussion, we don't need a pat on our back or a pat on our head to make us feel like we are worthy of something. There are many people in this country that are very talented, very educated. And when you have a situation where you're advancing people based on the color of their skin, unfortunately, they get into positions where they just can't keep up. I would say if there was affirmative action, say for Baltimore students to go off to Harvard, I would pity them, because we know that 9 out of 10 black boys in Baltimore City cannot read at grade level. So they would get to Harvard and ultimately fail. And so I don't want to see anybody that is promoted based on their skin or their gender, because I think it should be.
That's a bit of a misrepresentation of what's happening. Are you suggesting that people at Harvard were admitted who were incapable of doing the work comparable to the example just offered? I mean, the example you gave of 9 out of 10 boys in Baltimore going to Harvard, that's not at all what's happening. This isn't a hypothetical. People have been going to Harvard under affirmative action programs. Are you suggesting that those people weren't qualified?
Well, the Asian Americans that brought this case forth, they showed with data that there were many African-American students, many Hispanic students, and those that were elevated into these positions at Ivy League schools, unfortunately, had to drop out or fail because they just couldn't cut it at that level. That's actually part of their case that they brought to the Supreme Court.
People go to Harvard, Yale, Princeton, all these places. Not everyone graduates. Not everyone does well. For there to be an A student or a B student, there's going to be a C or a D student. The idea that these people were somehow unqualified or less than qualified because of their race is not empirically substantiated. And if you look at the Supreme Court's decision, their arguments weren't based on the data. They weren't based on a lack of performance or that the black people weren't qualified. That's not true. They made a more fundamental argument about a more fundamental moral claim and legal claim about what it means to allow race to be the deciding factor or a significant deciding factor as to whether someone could get in or not. So even if every black person got straight A's and was valedictorian at Harvard, they would have made the same determination no matter where they came from. So just to be clear about that. But race, to be clear, is not a factor, race is not the only decider as whether you get into these schools or not. The idea here is that race should be a factor given a long legacy of denied access. Tell me why you don't like that.
Well, I would say that we probably agree on abolishing like the legacy applicants, right? Those that have been in rich, white, wealthy families, sons of sons that get to go to the school because they have the same last name, right? The legacy applicants.
Sure.
I would say that you could abolish that and the affirmative action at the same time. I think you kind of just proved my point there. You're saying that skin color is not significant when considering some of these applicants that are black. So perfect. They don't need affirmative action at all.
No, I said it's not the only significant factor, meaning that when I'm admitting a student to Harvard, I am conscious of race to the extent that I want to have a representation of black people at the school. But these kids also have high SAT scores. These kids also have high GPAs. These kids also have strong applications.
Okay, well, it sounds like the Democrat Party would have to come together and talk to all those people in charge of admissions at these Ivy League schools, because this is a situation, honestly, Mark, that doesn't even involve Republicans. I mean, the Ivy League school administrators are liberal Democrats. They're the ones that are not taking and accepting black students to your standards. So this is a conversation you guys would have to have amongst each other.
Well, I'm not a Democrat, but the idea that it's not a Republican issue is interesting, because you got to keep in mind, it's not Democrats that are out here pushing to end these admissions. It's Republicans, and disaffected white men.
That's not true. The Asian Americans and the Asians that took this force to the Supreme Court, one of the women that actually was there in the courtroom was a Democrat representative on Capitol Hill, and she's Asian, and I believe it was her and Jemele Hill took her post and was poking jabs at her. But no, these are Democrats that brought this forward.
Bringing the case forward, but the argument against affirmative action has been a right-wing talking point for decades. You don't deny that, right?
No, I say that this has been a talking point really for Asian Americans and other immigrants for the most part.
Okay, you're saying that the Republican Party has not, prominent Republican voices have not consistently decried affirmative action and disagreed with affirmative action and taken public positions against affirmative action. That's what you're saying.
Do you have a name of one?
We could name a million of them. We could go to every U.S. president, Republican U.S. president for the last 30 years has said that they disagree with affirmative action. It is true. We could also name prominent, but again, we talk about prominent voices, Dinesh D'Souza, George Will, just to name two off the top of my head, who have very consistently and loudly said affirmative action is something they don't agree with. We have Jason Page. We have, I could keep going down the list of prominent Republicans. We could name all the Republican talking heads on major network television, from the Tucker Carlsons to the Bill O'Reillys to the Sean Hannitys. We could go on down the list. Glenn Beck. I mean, which one of those is not true that I just said?
Here's what I'll say. A lot of Republicans, Mark, don't...
No, you made a very specific point. You asked me to name one. I named 10. Are any of the 10 that I named incorrect? I'm just asking. Which one?
That is not true.
Oh, okay.
No, you can't even prove to me at any rate that these people said that. But here's what I'll say. A lot of Republicans do not touch this issue because they don't want to be labeled as a racist. So you've had a situation where, yes, if you think that they've talked about this in the past, who brought it forth? It was Asian Americans, and they are Democrats. That's who brought it forth. You can talk the talk all day long, but the people that walk the walk are within the Democrat Party, and they are, in fact, minorities.
Okay, I want everybody out there to do some Googling. You can Google the Michigan case, which is long before the Harvard case. You can Google all the names I just said, and you can very clearly say that all of them have spoken out against affirmative action. They've written columns on it. Some have written books on it. They've argued data on it. Candace Owens has done full 2-hour specials on it. I mean, we could go on down the list of lots of people, prominent, not so prominent, public, not more academic. We could go from journalism to the academy to political circles. It's just a fact, but we don't have to agree. Everybody stay right here, because let's be honest, some of y'all out there, not me, but some of y'all are giving black Republicans the side eye. Later on in the show, we're going to ask him why. We're going to help break down what's going on with the black Republicans in the United States and why they make the choices they make and why they want us to make different choices.